Magandang araw po muli sa lahat. Facebook. Actually, I was tapped as an emergency speaker for the Sunday school. I only learned of it last Friday after coming from a farm in Chaong and say no to the request. Pwedeng pilitin si Tun Rex. So, I was actually in a bind what topic that I can present today. That's the beauty of having studied in GMA. Pero ka pa nasa bool mahuhugot. So, I was considering R.C. Sproul. So, he's a very popular theologian, which I think many of are familiar with. But given the time where we are right now, where there's so much information around us, especially in this digital age, I thought this will be the more appropriate topic that I can present to you this morning. It's about Charles Spurgeon's The Sword and the Trowel. I think some of you are familiar with this. And maybe there are few of you who are subscribing to it. And napakaganda dito, no? And what you can see in the screen is the book. Actually, this is a book. I just copied this from the website of Amazon. So, but this is not the official seal or logo of the Sword and Trowel. And it is my intention to you this morning to give a glimpse or have a peek of what this sword and trowel is. Actually, this is a very good material. If you can get hold of it, you will really benefit from it. I'm not subscribing to it, but I just browsed it from time to time. And when you read what is being contained there, you can benefit from it. So having said that, let's just first have an overview about the sword and the trowel. By the way, I presume many of you are very familiar with Charles Spurgeon. You know? For those who are not aware, he is considered the prince of preachers. And having said that, he is well-respected around the world, especially in the Reformed circle, and even in the Reformed circle. And with the so many preachings that he has, if my memory is correct, information says he has more than 3,600 sermons in his lifetime. He died at the age of 57, and he pastored Metropolitan Tabernacle by, more than 37 years, because he became the pastor of that church at the age of 20, or almost 20. So he was a very productive preacher and theologian, we can say. And here, we will have a glimpse of the sword and the trowel, which he founded when he was the pastor of the Metropolitan Tabernacle. Okay, just an overview. So this The Sword and Trowel is the monthly magazine na established by Spurgeon, which actually began in 1865. That means he is only 21 years old when they established this magazine. He was born in 1834. So just immediately after he became a pastor, they decided to have the Sword and the Trowel. So what this Sword and Trowel, it is actually a magazine published monthly, and it contains articles, tracts, poetry, and book reviews, along with regular statistics and detailed reports and reflections on his sermons. So dito makikita natin how vast yung coverage ng The Sword and the Trowel. Mamaya, I will show you some samples of what he wrote there or what they wrote there, especially on the matters that are really controversial. Mamaya, i-discuss natin in passing yan. And again, The Sword and Trowel, most importantly, provides a rich source of biographical material on the preacher himself, Spurgeon, and the context of his ministry. Kasi nung time na yon, nung time na yon ay maraming challenges, ano, yung compromise, but Spurgeon, being the prince of preachers himself, he was so devoted in the expository preaching of God's word, so they made sure that by having this supplementary magazine, it gives those hearers and readers additional insight dun sa kanyang pagkatao and regarding their ministry. And also, it provides an it provides an illuminating inside look dun sa mga happenings dun sa kanyang church na Metropolitan Tabernacle at sa kanyang mga preaching. And as I mentioned earlier, it enjoys an extensive readership around the world. I try to compute it since nung mamatay siya ay 1892, but it's still ongoing right now. By next year, it will be having its 160th year. So meaning ngayon, 159th year na ng Metropolitan Tabernacle. And according to Tom Nettles, who wrote a book about Charles Spurgeon, it was mentioned there that Spurgeon said one of the reasons why he created this is he believed that in 500 years, what is being written here would still be useful in the next 500 years. So now, it's entering its 168th year, and true enough, it's still benefiting a lot of readers. And again, when I try to compute it, it has already produced, kung monthly ang kanilang production, that means they have already produced about 1,908 volumes of this magazine. Excluding pa yan kung meron silang special edition in between. But if you count it monthly, they have that much volume already. In fact, in Britain, maraming yung libraries there are full of Spurgeon's work. And for sure, this Sword and the Trowel is one of them. So that's just a short overview of this magazine. But it's very important to know what is the origin of this very fruitful and useful magazine started by Spurgeon himself. I hope you can read that. As I've said, it started in 1865. And during that time, 20 volumes ang kanilang pinublish kagad using yung kaibigan niyang deacon. Ito si Joseph Passmore, ay member ng kanilang iglesia, isang diakono. And he has a friend, yan si John Alabaster. They have a publishing company. So, during that time, believing that yung kanyang pinroduce na Sword and the Trowel needs to be published and circulated immediately. So, they established an agreement with Alabaster and Passmore and Alabaster Company, and they started producing the magazine. And this is the intent of Spurgeon, why he created the Sword and the Trowel. If you would read that, it's very clear. We would ply the trowel with untiring hand for the building up of Jerusalem's dilapidated walls and wield the sword with vigor and valor against the enemies of the truth. Bakit niya ito ang intention niya? Because during that time, there was so much happenings in the Christian circle. Remember, the Church of England during that time, even before he was born in 1834, but the year before, the Church of England is already compromising by the return of the Roman Catholics. Remember, during the Reformation, they already shunned out the Roman Catholic teachings, but later on, they veered away from the true faith and they allowed the Roman Catholic teachings to return. So, before he was born, nangyayari na yon. And finally, when he was there already, he saw what's happening. So, sabi nga niya, yan, we would ply the trowel. Alam niyo naman siguro yung trowel. If you can see in the logo, over there. Trowel there, pag tinignan niyo, parang pampalitada eh. Hindi yung trowel na pandukal, but I think it has both its purpose. Trowel, you can cultivate the word for that. Pero pag sinabing yun, building up of Jerusalem's dilapidated walls, so siguro yan yung pampalitada. That means to strengthen the truth of God's word. And there, also the second point is with vigor and valor. Meaning, kailangan matapang talaga sila because the those who are spreading the false news during that time were so aggressive. They were so strong. It was the Church of England who was doing that, and Spurgeon was really a strong voice that happened when they started this sword and trowel. So 20 years after, that's 1885, after the sword and trowel was born, Spurgeon understood that the battle lines have shifted. Sabihin, nag-ano na, hindi na simple lang, ano? To be sure, ritualism was still very much alive, but a new adversary had arisen whose influence was being felt not only in the Church of England, but among all denominations. So, hindi lang yung Church of England ang nag-compromise. Even in the Christian circle, mamaya makikita natin yan dun sa downgrade controversy, which I will explain in a bit. Ano? So, when Spurgeon saw that, sabi niya, grabe na nangyayari. And I cannot, despite my faithful preachings, this has not to be finished after lang ng preaching proper. Kailangan masustain yan. Meaning, dapat ma-recall yung mga truths na kanyang pinreach doon sa pulpit. And this is what he said, ano? For the moment, the main battle is with rationalism. I think we're all familiar with rationalism. Rationalism is the philosophy or belief or theory which says actions can only be justified through reasons or knowledge and no longer by the religious belief. So imagine, when the Reformation happened, people were so much immersed in the teachings of God. But because of ritualism and now rationalism, also with pragmatism, yun na nangyayari, natatabunan na pauti-uti yung doctrine ng Diyos. So yun ang nangyari, ano? And Spurgeon wants to address that. Sabi nga niya, we see comparatively little of overt atheism, deism, or honest infidelity. But we are surrounded by men who subscribe out creeds and hate them, enjoy our terms and attach false meanings to them, and even use our pulpits as places of vantage from which to assail the vital verities of our faith. So, the pulpit itself, even professing Christian churches, are now starting to veer away from the truth. That is what's happening during that time. And Spurgeon make it his personal cry that he will be a major voice to counter this false news being spread during his time. And here, you will see, yan ang original na itsura nung cover page ng The Sword and the Trowel. So, yung ano siguro, yung sa right portion ay medyo in-update na kunti yan. But that is the original picture of the magazine, The Sword and the Trowel. Now, so nakita na natin yung origin nun and dahilan kung bakit, what were the prevailing situations during that time. Now, ano ang main thrust talaga ng sword and the trowel? So Spurgeon was a staunch believer of writing. He believed in the power of the pen. And during that time, nung nandun siya, there are so many pastors, students, or ministers under his tutelage. Meaning, siya yung nag-oversee ng mga pastors na to. And he encourages writing aggressively or seriously. He believes with writing or the power of the pen, there are two fields of usefulness. Sabi nga niya, first is the utterance of truth with the living voice as their main work. So what he's saying here is napaka-importante pa rin talaga ng verbal preaching ng gospel. Yan pa rin ang first and foremost. Okay? Kaya ang iba, doon na lang nag-focus. But on the second one, sabi nga doon, the publishing of the same truth by means of the press, that is in written form, is barely second in importance. So meaning, yung iba, inaano na yon, parang hindi yan ganun kalaga. But yan, no. It is also very important. And should be used to the full measure of each man's ability. So having that in mind, with the verbal preaching, is very important. Not that the verbal preaching of the gospel cannot stand by itself, but there is much more when there is the written supplement of it. So yun ang napakaganda. That's how Spurgeon fully understood the power of the pen. And yun nga din, isa sa mga intentions nila, goal nila, is to uplift the banner of peculiar, or we can say distinctive, associations of Christians because of the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Kasi nga, grabbing false news na, false gospel na ang nag-i-spread noon. But they need to raise the flag much higher. That's why they need this kind of written supplement by way of the sword and the trowel. And isang intention din nila is to report the efforts of those churches and associations which are more or less intimately connected with the Lord's work at the Metropolitan Tabernacle. So it's just like what's happening right now. Hindi lang yung kanilang church ang kanyang hina-highlight, bagamat napakasikat talaga ng iglesia nila. Siguro kung nabasa natin yan, their attendees number to the tens of thousands. And later on, actually, they have to go to another place from their Metropolitan Tabernacle because it can only accommodate 5,000 seated attendees with an extra 1,000. And meron silang, nakalimutan ko yung name, they transferred to a venue wherein it can accommodate 12,000 attendees. So you can imagine the impact, the magnitude that Spurgeon had. And also, they want to advocate those views of doctrine and church in order to be scattered everywhere. Their friends are so numerous as to be able to maintain a magazine and so earnest as to require one. Marami ng mga iglesia rin noon, no? But they don't have the capability to come up with magazines like the Metropolitan Tabernacle. So for them, they find it essential that by having this written form or of, regarding the doctrines of the church, nakakatulong sila sa mga iglesyang yon. Dahil yung mga ibang iglesia na yon, kahit gusto nila, wala silang capability. So yan, nakita nila, so this definitely would help them. And also, a supplement to their weekly sermons, which I just mentioned a while ago, to inform the general Christian public of their movements and show their sympathy with all that is good throughout the entire Church of God. Why? Because it's no different like now. When the unbelievers look at Christians, lalo na ang Baptist, ano? Ako, I had this impression before when I was also already a Christian. Pag sinabing Baptist, ay mga hindi makabasag pinggan yung mga yan. That's a fact. Alam natin yan. But by having this kind of written form, reporting to the public, both to the general public, and of course, also later on, doon sa kanilang mga members, ay nakikita ngayon what is really happening to the Church of God. Okay? So nagkakaroon ngayon ng glimpse yung mga tao sa labas, normal na mga tao pala yung nasa loob ng Metropolitan Tabernacle. They are not the holier than thou, as some perceive it to be. Okay? Also, in continuation of that, ito, to have an opportunity of urging the claims of Christ's cause and advocating the revival of godliness, denouncing error, of bearing witness for truth, and of encouraging the laborers in the Lord's vineyard. Yung previous statement sinabi ko, that was more for the general public, but by having this written form, especially yung after ng sermon, it gives the opportunity for their members or for those attenders who may not be tuned in. Baka nandun, natutulog lang o umaattend lang, but when you have the written form, they now have the opportunity to read, ito pala yung pinreach nitong araw na ito. Diba? Mapakalaking bagay na we have this privilege right now. Before, wala tayong ganitong pagkakataon na yung mga pinipreach dito na tatranscribe, na papublish. But now we have like that. Like the pulpit booklet. Meron na tayo niyan. Now, pagkatapos lang nung preaching, our illustrious brothers post it immediately dun sa ating group chat or even dun sa Facebook. And it gives the opportunity for the believers to, for those who were not tuning in, baka sila, masama pakiramdam noon nung nakikinig sila, or talagang wala lang yung sarili nila nung nandun sila sa loob ng panambahan. Pero later on, as the Lord impresses on them, this is the beautiful message that you miss. So may opportunity na ngayon, and that's what the sword and the trowel did when they have this kind of published material. It was also their intention for them to be identified as not unsectarian, but with distinctive principles. Remember, we are discussing now our distinctives in our Sunday school. So, napaka-importante yun. Hindi lang sila na parang sinasabi na, hindi, ganito lang kami. No, we have a distinction. We are carrying the name of Christ. But they have the desire to please parties of all shades of opinion. So, hindi naman sila arrogante, no? They still want to make sure na yung makakabasa nun ay maantig or mapiplease dahil hindi sila arrogante. But take note those in bold fonts. Sabi dito, they spoke in love but not in soft words and trimming sentences. They did not intend to court controversy, but they did not shun it when the cause of God demanded it. And that's the supplement to what I just presented a while ago in the previous slide, yung intention is Spurgeon. No? They want to please for those hearers, pero hindi sila mahihiya, hindi sila matatakot when it comes to the truth of the gospel. Kailangan yun because of the fake gospel being spread right during that time, the errors and those who oppose it, kailangan talaga in a gentle fashion yet bold and courageous. So yun ang ginagawa ng the sword and the trowel. And the many ministers who were students in their college were their helpers in maintaining a variety of freshness of matter to have their flocks receive a blessing through their striking words. It was their first and last objective to do practical service and to excite others to active exertion. What this means is that ginagamit din or yung mga nakasamang mga, even the younger pastors, ay pinapakita na Spurgeon did not have that domineering attitude. Hindi lang yung kanyang nasa isip, hindi lang yung sinabi niya ang nangingibabaw doon. He was open to the ideas, he was open to the insights of those under his tutelage so that it brings in fresh perspectives doon sa mga nilalagay nilang article. What indeed a very nice attitude from the Prince of Preacher himself. Diba? Alam natin marami mga pastor ngayon na especially they are so learned, matagal na sila sa ministeryo, but when new perspectives come, lalo kung theologically sound naman, sometimes they don't consider. But Spurgeon did not do it. Ginamit niya yung opportunity. And those were highlighted in the output of the sword and the trowel. They supplied interesting reading upon general topics, but their chief aim was to arouse believers to action and to suggest them plans by which the kingdom of Jesus may be extended. So, mamaya makikita natin yung range ng topic. Kanina sinabi ko, di ba? Ang daming nilang kinocover na topics. Mostly, of course, from the doctrines, umaabot sila hanggang sa social issues. Na mamaya, makikita natin, I will be citing, I think, 5 of those samples, and makikita natin how Spurgeon addressed them and presented them to through the sword and the trowel. And ito nga, in the publication proper, they issued 2 one-page tracts each month. So I mentioned a while ago, nung kinumpute ko, kung January 1865, nagsimula yon, they should have produced about 1,908 volumes na, more or less, to this date, excluding kung meron silang special releases. That's quite a lot of volume of production when it comes to writing. And they made it suitable for general distribution and so cheap as to be readily purchasable in large quantities. They also supplied outlines of sermons and Sabbath school addresses. They gave suggestions as to methods of usefulness and labor to assist all the workers in the master's vineyard by every means in their prayer. And we are beneficiaries of this. Tayo nakikita natin yan. And this is where I commend the laborers of our church in the multimedia ministry. As we put them in social media, in our Facebook, yung ating schedule, yung sa calendars natin, even after the preaching, makikita natin yung highlights. Actually, this set an example to many churches in the country right now. When I see our sister churches following suit, masaya ka kasi nakita mo yung impluensya. I don't know if we were the first, but I am confident that we can be one of those first who started it, and many churches are doing that right now. And makikita natin, it all goes back to how the sword and the trowel also did it almost 160 years ago. So, doon nakita natin, no? I gave you an overview, the origin of the sword and the trowel, and their main thrust or their main intention and main goal, why they want it to happen. So now, as I mentioned, I will be giving you samples of articles in the sword and the trowel. So simulan natin yung kanilang pinaka-maiden na year, January 1865. This is about the preaching of Spurgeon. This is just an overview. Hindi ko di-discuss yung buong laman nun, no? So, in this sermon, Spurgeon uses King Xerxes' command to honor Mordecai as an illustration of how God has exalted His Son, Jesus Christ. So meaning, doctrine muna. Spurgeon underscored the value, the importance of focusing on the doctrine muna. What the scriptures say. So after an encouraging meditation on the supremacy of Christ, he moved to the reflection on how Christians may bring honor to Christ by serving Him. So now, from the doctrine, he now shows the practical application in his preaching in this written form. And one particular note dito sa publication na to is that, as Spurgeon shares, this was written to him by one of the elders of their church, recommending 10 ideas for pursuing a larger outpouring of the Holy Spirit on our church and congregation. So dito makikita natin, ano, yung sinabi ko kanina, Spurgeon was very open to the inputs of his members. He did not have a domineering attitude. Kahit siya yung talaga napakagaling, no? Kinonsider niya yung suggestion na binigay ng kasama niya, and he included that in the publication. So that should be the kind of character that we need to cultivate, no? Whether it be doctrine, whether it be application, we don't command solely, kahit gaano tayo kadunong, kahit gaano natin kaalam ang Biblia, tayo ay natututo sa kapwa mananampalataya, di ba? Proverbs 27, tama ba? 17, iron sharpens iron. So, and here, Spurgeon was able to show it dun sa kanyang sword and the trowel. Next sample was the August 1865. This is regarding Dr. Campbell's reaction on Spurgeon's baptismal regeneration sermons. So, nung June 5, 1864, oral report to, kaya alam ko to. So, I mean, Spurgeon preached about Mark 16, verses 15 to 16. It is regarding Jesus' command to go preach the gospel to all nations, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But during that time, ang Church of England was espousing baptismal regeneration. Baptismal regeneration is actually a product of the Catholic Church, of their Catechism 12, number 1215. What does it say? Baptism is the way for salvation. And we know that's heresy. Di ba? Magkakaroon lang ng regeneration ang isang tao kung siya ay mabaptize. No, that's wrong. We all know that regeneration happens when God calls the sinner, and there the regeneration happens that brings him to faith and that brings him to repentance and come to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's very clear. Alam na natin na yan. Na-preach na yan many times. Naituro na yan dito. And that is where Spurgeon was really so indignant with that kind of teaching. So in June 5, 1864, he made that preaching. And Dr. Campbell is from the Campbellite movement in America among Baptists, and which eventually broke off to become its own denomination, the Disciples of Christ. So what happened was that Campbell taught a Credo Baptist form of baptismal regeneration. So meaning tinatanggap niya rin yung wrong teaching na yon, ano? So, and he spoke against Spurgeon for his condemnation of baptismal regeneration. Just again, an additional information, after Spurgeon preached that baptismal regeneration sermon, 100,000 copies of that sermon went into circulation. 180,000 immediately. But I think in 2 weeks' time, it ballooned to 350,000. You can imagine the impact with no internet, with no computer, only printing press, the magnitude of that sermon by Spurgeon. So, marami ang tumutuligsa sa kanya, and there was no church who is no longer aware of that sermon by Spurgeon. And Campbell was criticizing him. But later on, after the controversy had somewhat settled, Campbell published a series of letters presenting a more thoughtful analysis and expressing his support of Spurgeon. You see the turnaround? Diba? So yung print noon, I don't know if it was already in the Sword and the Trowel. Not yet in the Sword and Trowel publication pa ata yun. So, Campbell finally realizing that Spurgeon has a point. Tama pala siya. You can see the power of the printed material. Kasi kung titingnan niya lang yung ano, wala pang video noon. Remember, wala pang video recordings during that time. Kung hindi ka umaten noon at narinig mo lang, chances are you will probably hear a downgraded version or baka mali pa. Pero nung binasa niya, ito yung laman ng sermon ko. So finally, Campbell realized na tama pala si Spurgeon. So what happens that Spurgeon appreciated Campbell's letters and published the introduction in The Sword and the Trowel. Because of his relationship with Campbell, some of the followers of Dr. Campbell have sought to show that the two of them were not far apart in their understanding of baptism. So you see how the errors have been cleared out, how they have been corrected because of the published material. So, Spurgeon, instead of being combative, pwede naman niyang hindi nabanggitin si Campbell eh. Diba? Pero ipinablish niya. Nakita niya na ito. Sabi niya, we can be gentle, but we have to be firm. And that was clearly shown in the publication of The Sword and the Trowel. Now, next, in November 1868, so we moved 3 years later, Be Just, Fear Not, a track for the elections. So sabi ko kanina, nagsimula sa doctrine, ngayon may mga false issues, eto social issue na. It doesn't mean that we have to interfere in what's happening in the government, but this has a very significant impact. This is regarding the elections dun sa Ireland, no? So, sabi nga, outside of the pulpit, Spurgeon did not hesitate to speak up on political issues. And this tract is one example. While the author is not explicitly stated, it is clearly connected with him. So, ito regarding, sabi ko nga, no, in Ireland, as the vote for the disestablishment of the Church of Ireland approach, Spurgeon wanted to provide a response for the conservatives who opposed this disestablishment. Their argument was that an established church preserved Protestantism in Ireland. So what is happening there is they want to have a state church na mag-iimpluwensya para yung Roman Catholicism ay hindi mag-progress. Kung sasabihin ng gobyerno, hindi, kailangan mali yan eh. No? Protestantism is the national religion of Ireland. But Spurgeon disagreed with that. Because he believes the separation of the church and the state. And that's how it should be. We were taught with that many times ago. So, he, however, believed that any form of established religion was a form of injustice. Kasi pinipersecute yung mga Roman Catholics noon. Kahit Protestant ka, and you are against the Roman Catholic teaching for Spurgeon, that's not right. So, rather than using the coercive tools of third state church, they should work towards the religious liberty and grant all people religious freedom, even Catholics. That is what's being taught to us. Diba kaya nga, you've heard many times from pastor, merong may ginawa ang bansa natin, National Baptist Day ba, tama ba ako? You're not happy with that. They don't have any business interfering in the affairs of the church. We run our own affairs based on how the scriptures teaches us. And this was the statement of Spurgeon, better far to be persecuted for righteousness' sake than to do violence to other men's consciences under the notion of upholding the truth in the name of our Reformed faith. Let no Romanist suffer injustice at our hands, lest our good cause be defiled. So, malinaw. Because here, Spurgeon knows that you are already putting in man's hands the cause of the gospel. He trusted the gospel to work its way on the hearts of men, even the Roman Catholics. So that's why he was a staunch supporter of the separation of the church and the state. And ito, so nakita na natin from the doctrine, okay? And then, ngayon hanggang umabot na dun sa political spectrum, dito naman, regarding naman sa internal naman sa church nila. When it comes to church polity, how they run their affairs. So, gaya na sinabi ko kanina, many outsiders, especially unbelievers, don't have any idea what's happening in the Christian church. Pag nakikita lang nila, halimbawa sa mga Pentecostal, hallelujah, hallelujah lang yan, but we are not contemptuous with them. Much more with the Baptist. Hindi na alam kung ano nangyari dito. So, in that article in February 1869 regarding the discipline of the church, their church, Metropolitan Tabernacle, ito ay sinulat ng kanyang kapatid na si James and also his co-pastor. So, what does it contain? It provides a complete description of the church polity of the Metropolitan Tabernacle, particularly the offices of the elders and deacons in the church, their membership practices, receiving and church discipline in the organization of the ministries of the church. We have also heard that many times how important church discipline is. When it comes to polity, alam natin ang role ng mga elders, ng mga deacons. Alam natin that the marks of an essential church next to the preaching, faithful preaching of God's word, is the implementation of the sacraments instituted by God, yung dalawa, alam natin, baptism and Lord's Supper, and also instituting church discipline. So, para may pakita nila na itong ginagawa namin, hindi namin tinotolerate kahit may mga mali yung aming mga miyembro. Because there are those who say, wala namang ginagawa yung iglesyang yan eh. Ano? So, ito, basahin ko lang, doon sa introduction, yung kapatid niya, James Spurgeon, makes clear that they do not present their practices as the perfect or only way to organize a church. So yan, malinaw yan, no? At the same time, they observe a laxity among evangelical churches in their discipline and have limited confidence in letters of commendation from our churches. So yun, they're just trying to show this is how we do things, but they are not dictating to other churches. So it's up to them. Kung nakita nila, effective pala yung ginagawa ng Metropolitan Tabernacle. Why not? But if they don't put it into publication, how would the other churches know that they are being lax or not actually implementing that? So, therefore, in presenting their methods, Spurgeon encourages other churches to examine their own polity. Yun na yung sinabi ko. And apart from this kind of confidence in each other's practices, any church cooperation will be ultimately ineffective. So nakikita natin, no? Who would dare Like tayo, halimbawa, meron, we believe we're not a perfect church. Alam na natin yan. And there are things which we want to know. But it goes without saying that we are timid to go to a church and ask, ginagawa niyo ba ito? Siyempre, mahihiya tayo. Mahirap yon. But if there's a published material that you see, ganito pala yung ginagawa ng ating sister church. So we learn from there. And that's what Spurgeon did. What his brother wrote in this article in February 1869. And now we come now to my last sample. These are just five. Napakarami na hindi natin kayang explore lahat yan. I just cited examples just to show you the range of Spurgeon's coverage when it comes to those things that they were putting in the sword and the trowel to make sure that they are beneficial to the hearers. Now, this is the downgrade controversy in March 1887. So, ito yung nagsimula when there was the publication of two articles in the journal during that year, which were actually the product of Spurgeon's close friend na si Robert Schindler. Actually, hindi si Spurgeon himself who wrote this. But, mamaya, elaborate ka lang na konti, no? So, Spurgeon inserted a footnote on the first page of each of the downgrade articles where he called for earnest attention on the part of the readers with the urgent warning that we are going downhill at breakneck speed. Ang pinagmumulan kasi nito during the time, nung sinabi ko kanina sa introduction or the early part ng presentation, the church is veering away from the truth. Okay? But now, that's understandable dun sa mga medyo mababaw. But here, it's his fellow Baptists who is doing this this compromise. They're downgrading the truth. And what happens that they also associate with those na kumukontra dun sa katotohanan ng Diyos. And Spurgeon was not a coward to call out the attention of his fellow Baptists. In fact, the downgrade controversy was the most dramatic and the most disastrous episode in Spurgeon's career. Kanina binanggit ko yung sa baptismal regeneration, that was one, and this was also pinakamatindi, no, yung sa downgrade controversy. It was the severest crisis ever faced by the Baptist Union, the body to which Spurgeon belonged, that led to his later separation from. Umalis siya doon. Imagine how painful is that. We hear the separation of the churches, division among churches, and we know how painful is that. How much more for the Prince of Preachers? But he had no choice. He had to because he cannot afford to compromise. And this is what he said in the preface of that sword and the trowel issue. Ito sinabi niya. We have had enough of the downgrade for ourselves when we have looked down upon it. What havoc false doctrine is making, no tongue can tell. Assuredly, the new theology can do no good towards God or man. It has no adaptation for it. If it were preached for 1,000 years by all the most earnest men of the school, it would never renew a soul nor overcome pride in a single human heart. The sword and trowel have both been used this year with all our might. We have built up the wall of the city and have both tried to smite the king's enemies. How could we help it? No loyal soldier could endure to see his lord's cause so grievously wronged by traitors. Something will come of the struggle over the downgrade. Such a very scathing remark from Spurgeon himself. And that caused his association with the Baptist Union. So these are just five of the samples which I cited to show you the scope of what they were putting, what they were writing in the sword and the trowel. And right now, we are still beneficiaries of what has been placed there. And it continues into circulation. I try to track down how many they are producing right now, but hindi ko makita yung data. But it goes without saying that it remains in production. And ito na ang itsura ngayon ng magazine ng The Sword and the Trowel. So makita niyo yan, yung version, yung 2020, 2022, 2023, meron pang 2024. Okay? So almost 160 years, the Lord has been faithful to support this endeavor of the Metropolitan Tabernacle through the leadership on Charles Spurgeon. And having a glimpse of this magazine, I would like to draw this simple lesson from this. The use of published materials as supplement for the primary verbal proclamation of the truth. That is, again, sinabi ko kanina, first and foremost is the public preaching of the word, but now this is supplement of the truth of the word. It's proven very useful for the reverberating effect to the hearers and readers, whether it be in simple proclamation of the gospel or decrying unbiblical teaching and application of the scriptures. The samples that I just mentioned to you are very clear. And our church, by the grace of God, has been doing that. Maybe not as like the magnitude of the sword and the trowel already accomplished, but in the Lord's time, kung di pa babalik ang Panginoong Hesukristo, it's our desire that what we have started, yung pulpit booklet, remember yung sow your seed? May ibang iglesia na gumagamit niyan. Actually, hindi nga nagpaalam kay Pastor. No? So, it just shows the power of the written form of yung mga ginagawa sa iglesia natin. And many are benefiting from it. So, having learned this lesson, I'd like to throw this challenge to each one of us. No? I believe God has given us each gift. And some definitely are writing, especially when we are learned people. Explore and be a willing lender of your gifts in writing or in any multimedia specialties that will aid in the production of the church published evangelizing endeavors. We live in a digital age right now, brothers and sisters and friends, but we can never do away with writing. Writing does not simply mean on the pen itself. Well and good. Actually, I prefer writing because when I write, I can easily recall what I write, but even typing it, it really helps a lot in the cause of spreading or evangelizing this sinful work. That ends my question. Any questions? Wala si Ate Jean, kaya paired ako na.
Thank you for sharing. I'm not familiar with the trowel and the
sword and the trowel.
The sword and the trowel. I haven't seen one. My question is, so that was started when the Metropolitan Church was still there. Spurgeon was still preaching.
Yeah.
So now that he is gone, I noticed we're using also his devotions in our
handouts.
Yeah. So talagang may timelessness yung method niya, no? And the way he expresses truth. So nowadays, ano yung nagiging material niya? Because the Metropolitan Church, is it still existing?
Yes, it's still existing.
Oh, it's still existing, but Spurgeon is not there anymore.
Yeah. So, yeah. Thank you for the question.
In the same way, Table Talk yata magazine is also R.C. Sproul, right?
Yeah.
He's already passed away already.
Yeah.
So, are you saying that these two examples, because they were started by great men of God, they still continue even to the present age because of the insights, very deep insights of these extraordinary leaders na can, it's wala siyang expiration date, and the way they handle the truth ay talaga ganun. So yeah. Is that the value of this magazine?
Yeah, you could have not said it better. Exactly. That's why when I mentioned earlier in the book, as Tom Nettle cited an expression or statement of Sir John, he believes it's just like the scriptures. The scriptures has been written thousands of years ago, and we are still benefiting from it. We are still reading it. It remains fresh. So it's the same as how God used this mighty man. Remember John Calvin, his institute, Augustine's, which are older than what Spurgeon and Sproul had started. And even though they are old, but they remain fresh because they are anchored on the scriptures themselves. So whenever, this is a personal experience when we were given an assignment. Actually, I rarely read Spurgeon's articles about him. But when we were given an assignment in GMA, and I read it, it was very simple, but it was really very beautiful. Imagine that was written 160 years ago or more. It remains fresh. Why? Because it was about God Himself. It was about the scriptures, which we can say by the illumination of the Holy Spirit makes the message still fresh. And this is, as I mentioned a while ago, Spurgeon believed that this would still be useful 500 years from now, unless the Lord returns earlier. I think that is so. 160 years ago, it was written. Now we are still benefiting from it. Very same. That's why we cannot underestimate what we are doing right now. When I see brethren, especially young people who are transcribing the messages being preached here, and when you read it back, remember some are taking notes. And it goes without saying, you can err in writing the points, but you have something to go back to and see, oh, this is actually the message during that. But if you don't have that kind, and you were here on that day, you feel sleepy, you miss the point. You miss the message of God's word. But with the written form, you can always go back to it. That's the beauty of having the written form. That's why Spurgeon believe in the power of the pen. Thank you, Adi. Any more questions? Yes. Tita Te. Sige po.
Medyo nabuhay ako dun sa challenge. And I think this church, like all other churches, gifted with talented, God-fearing members, which I think they can use the media or the print or the pen to express the goodness of God so that others can learn. Yun yatang hinahanap ko rito, sabi ko. Yung mga ano kasi, mga nakikita, hindi kasi ako masyado sa ano eh. Pero I think, dahil napaka, alam ko marami dito ang members na gifted with writing, gifted with telling others about God, about the goodness of God. And that could be a good way also of evangelizing through the print, through siguro si Spurgeon, if he did not do it, there's nothing can learn today.
Yeah.
So, ipagpatuloy natin yung may, ang ano lang yung bang medyo takot lang, medyo nahihiya, medyo na ano, isa yun sa dapat na i-overcome natin kasi takot tayo na makriticize. Maraming kinatatakutan na ano, no? At yung iba naman, busy talaga, no? But I think this church and all other churches can use the print in order to bring people to Christ, to manifest yung go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations. Yun lang ang aking pwedeng sabihin. The print. Yung the print, kailangan isagawa natin ngayon. hindi lang sa bibig o sa idea, kung hindi, kumilos tayo. Salamat.
Maraming salamat po, Tita Te. Totoo po yan, no? Alam naman natin na ang Grace Baptist Church ay pinagpala ng maraming, sabi nating natuto or nakapag-aral na mga miyembro, no meaning to be derogatory doon sa mga hindi masyado nakapag-aral, but the Lord has truly spread the gifts to each one. And yeah, we have the opportunity to use that gift even in simple matters. Imagine yung pinakita ko nga kanina, yung mga nasa under ni Spurgeon, eh definitely hindi niya kasing level yon, but they were not afraid to learn. I think that's one thing that we need to develop also. And huwag tayo mahiya magtanong. Mapalad tayo that we are blessed with a pastor who is really gifted when it comes to the doctrines, the theology. We can always ask him anytime. And we have members who have already studied. And kahit yung hindi pa nakapag-study sa GMA, marami tayo mga miyembro na marunong. But yeah, we have to use that, you know, and overcome that timidity as the Lord enables, and use that to help in the writing. And a personal take ko rin po dito kasi is why we encourage writing is, look, there is while we are blessed with the digital technology right now, wherein when you write something, you can easily edit, you can easily spread, but there is always the danger. I think a few months ago, there was something glitch that happened. Nakalimutan kong sa Microsoft ba yun? And it caused havoc in some systems. Diba? Like, if you have all your materials, imagine kung wala tayong print materials, and suddenly, the system collapses, the internet collapses. You can no longer access your e-books, your communication. What happens? We're done. But if you have the print material, you can easily go back to that. They may be heavy, but they will always come handy when the time arises for it. Yes, you can go.
Siguro ako sa pinakamatanda dito. During that time, actually, we have actually publications ngayon, kagaya ng sinabi ni Brother Ike na meron tayong publication, which started noon siguro. Maganda din yun. We have we have Baptist Contender. So yung mga hindi lang isang nagsusulat, kundi marami, may poem pa nga tayo doon. Then after Baptist Contender, naging Herald of Revival. Tapos naging, doon muna. Tapos after that, naging Herald of Reformation. So yun ang, maraming mga articles, mga members nagsusulat, may mga poems pa doon, may Tagalog version, may Tagalog section, may... So very nice, which I'm also dinidig up ko pa ngayon minsan kasi gumagawa ng Bible study, magandang materials doon, may meron din other from other churches nagko-contribute, siguro ipakita natin 'yon. Then ngayon medyo marami ding, then si pastor na ngayon ay ang version ay tina-translate natin yung mga preaching, which is also very good. Nata-transcribe natin na naging Baptist. Ano yun? Naging Herald of Reformation na. So, nandun na yun tayo at meron tang other things. So, paano natin i-strengthen ito?
Yeah.
Baka siguro marami din, mayroon tayong mga iba dyan na gumagawa ng hymn. Pwede natin i-publish doon. May mga poems ba tayo? Kasi I profit really from those. At maraming mga members na may editorial. I remember ako kasi hindi ako marunong magsulat. Ako taga-publish na lang doon, mga pag-layout noon, tayo manual, mano-mano yon. At pati yung mga artist nating cover. So, I'm just giving you the history na meron tayong ganun. Mga, siguro i-revive din natin yun. Digitalized yun. I think that's I'm just giving you. Thank you. Kung may dagdag kamay or...
Okay, maraming salamat, Deacon Glenn. And I fully agree, ano, kanina nga sinabi nga ni Tita Te, ayan, sinabi ni Deacon Glenn, na our church is blessed with so much gifts, but there are still those who are quite timid of using their gifts. Hindi mo kailangan magaling ka sa writing, but there are so many messages that still has to be transcribed. And nakita natin yan, I am a personal witness how other churches are benefiting from this. Imagine the recently published Christian Holiness of our adult Sunday school, ginagamit niya ng ibang iglesia. But there is a vast collection of messages that we still have that need to be transcribed. So if the Lord is convicting you to be part of that, hindi naman kailangan outstanding kagad yung output nyo eh. Start with one, di ba? It pays to start with a single step, then let it flow. Habang buhay tayo, gamitin na natin yung ating ano. Kahit, huwag naman yung spare time. But the Lord will enable you to be of use dito sa ministry. Thank you, Deacon Clint. Meron pa? Ha? Ah, yes, preferably.
Gusto ko lang i-share, Deacon Ike, yung parang pinaka-objective talaga ng the sword and the trowel. Yung talagang hindi pag-lundo sa katotohanan ng salita ng Diyos na sa kabila nga ng mga oppositions ay Spurgeon like Campbell and many others and many churches or pastors, no, talagang against him, parang against all odds. Naging kalalagay ni Spurgeon, pero yung magandang bagay sa kabila ng oppositions, nakita natin kay Alexander Campbell na siya mismo, ay nakita niya na mali pala ako, tama si Spurgeon. So, it can happen kasi they can Ike sa church. Even in, sa anong mangyari, sabihin sa isang Reformed Baptist Church, sino mang iglesia na tumatayo sa salita ng Diyos, pwedeng maging malundo tayo sa salita ng Diyos. So huwag tayong maging parang mayabang doon sa ganung bahagi. Pero Spurgeon talagang makakita natin. Ako kasi personally, hindi ko nabasa yung The Sword and the Trowel, but nakakabasa ako ng mga libro patungkol doon at kung paano nanindigan si Spurgeon. Ano nga siya, yung ba talagang sobrang stress. Kasi imagine, parang lahat, daming mga against sa kanya at sa uli, and even sa kanya kamatayan ay yung mga against sa kanya ay parang nagbigay nga ng tribute or sa kanya. Talagang hanga-hanga at magiging Spurgeon for sure. Pero hindi talaga tayong manindigan kahit sa sabi nating ordinary members sa church, manindigan sa katotohanan ng salita ng Diyos. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Ferdy. Yeah, I mentioned a while ago na minsan pag nakikinig tayo, baka mali yung rinig natin. Diba? Na ito pala yung message, but for some reasons, you overlook. Imagine what a single word can change. Like the not and without the not. Diba? It totally changes the meaning of a statement. Pero pag pinakinggan mo, hindi mo naisulat yon. Ba't ganito sinabi ni pastor? O ba't ganito sinabi ng preacher? Pero nung tinignan mo yung, pinakinggan mo yung video or yung print material, ay meron pala nito. Ako, mali. So you can see the value when we have this kind of privilege now in the digital age, combination of in the net, in the internet, and also the written form, how blessed are we? And does it not challenge you to be part of the church's ministry to spread that truth coming from scriptures? Sana maging malinaw sa atin yon, ano? Hindi mo kailangan maging outstanding, hindi mo kailangan maging nasa front line, no? Mas maganda pa nga minsan nasa likod eh, no? Pero yon, basta yung pagsulong ng ebanghelyo ng Panginoong Hesus Kristo ay nagpapatuloy. Diba? Yung forgot which verse, even yung simpleng pagbigay ng malamig na tubig ng bata, hindi yun nawawala sa diwa ng Diyos. Yun ay may gantimpala mula sa kanya. Last question, if any? Si Tita Te. Thank you, Barbara.
Sabi kasi, faith without work is a dead faith. Kaya, ano natin? I think kung meron nang naumpisahan, kaparis ang sinabi ni Deacon Glenn, meron nang naumpisahan noon na print na mga testimonies na na-print so that we can learn from each other and we can spread the word to other people para ano maging active ang ating evangelizing at ang ating pagsunod sa sinasabi ng Panginoon. Isagawa na natin. Isagawa na natin, hindi lang sa salita, kundi isagawa. Yun lang ang gusto kong makita na sana aktibo tayo, pati lahat ng young people na ano ay mag-participate din dito sa napakagandang adhikain na alam ko na adhikain din ng Panginoon.
Thank you po, Tita Te. I second the motion. Hindi lang po sa mga bata, ano, kundi po kahit kanino, the passing generation like we, can still be useful in this ministry. And I reiterate, it is that your contribution doesn't have to be outstanding. Ano, kahit maliit lang yan, but it adds up to the overall output in achieving the goal of the ministry, then the Lord definitely is delighted in that. Sana yun talaga maging glittering challenge sa atin, no? And that we should take it really very seriously. Okay, with that, let us close in prayer. Aming dakilang Diyos at banal na amang nasa langit, kami po ay nagpapasalamat sa inyong kabutihan na ginawaran kami ng pagkakataon na masilayan, magkaroon ng kunting background sa ginawa ng inyong lingkod ni Charles Spurgeon, yung The Sword and the Trowel. Pinakita po dito, Panginoon, kung ano ang nagbunsod para ito ay pasimulan niya upang magamit ang mga angkop na kaloob ng mga mananampalataya para gamitin ang kanilang mga talento sa larangan ng pagsusulat bilang suplemento sa pagpapakalat ng katotohanan ng Ebanghelyo. Salamat sa mga ehemplong kanilang ginamit, Panginoon, na sinulat nila more than 150 years ago, yet like the great theologians, the great men that you have raised thousands of years ago, we continue to benefit from their undertakings. At salamat po, Panginoon, nawa yun ay tunay na magamit namin mahamon ng iglesyang ito, Panginoon, na bagamat hindi kalilimutan ang pangunahin na pamamaraan, ang pagpapahayag ng ebanghelyo sa iglesyang ito, ay tunay na magamit ang mga kaloob na ito para lalo pang mapabilis at mapag-ibayo ang pagpapakalat ng salita ng Panginoong Yesus, hindi lamang sa iglesyang to, hindi lamang sa mga kapatid namin iglesia, kundi lalong-lalo na sa mga wala pa sa Panginoong Yesus. Salamat, Panginoon, sa mga ginamit mong mga taong ito at tunay na maging malinaw lalo ang inyong katuruan sa aming kalagitnaan. And Lord, we continue to plead to you to prepare us also for the remaining worship this afternoon. Prepare us, O Lord, and may we delight in all the messages that we will hear today and leave this place not being blessed by your word, but truly benefit from it and praise you all the more. For we lift all of these things to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.